Hello, good evening, and welcome to a very special Most Haunted Live. I'm standing outside of Eastern State Penitentiary in the heart of Philadelphia, a place that can only be described as hell on earth for all of those who occupied it. For the next 7 hours, we will be investigating this foreboding structure. So join me, Yvette Fielding, as I unleash the demons of Eastern State Penitentiary. A piece of fascinating history. It is, of course, the Eastern State Penitentiary. For the next 7 hours, we're going to be investigating this place, and I hope to share with you some of the secrets of this terrifying building. Now, we're literally going to be here from dusk right through to dawn, and I hope that you'll stay with us and join in this very, very scary journey. Now, of course, before we get everything underway, I want you to meet some members of the investigation team. The first person is a man who, without him, we couldn't do Most Haunted at all. He is somebody who guides us and protects us when we do our investigations. He's our medium and psychic, David Wells. Hi, David. How are you?
Hello. I'm okay.
Now, this has to be the most extraordinary investigation we're ever going to undertake. Mm-hmm. Normally, we do 3 nights, and each night we do 3 hours.
Yeah.
This particular night, it's 7 hours long. How on earth are you going to cope with that?
I'm going to have to pace myself. I'm going to have to watch my energy, more importantly. There was a full moon last night, so that's going to help the whole place be buzzing, which, of course, is going to drain us even more. Mm. So it's a case, so it's just really about taking our time, but we'll go at their pace eventually, you know.
Okay. So, of course, we couldn't do Most Haunted without the investigation team. They're very courageous and very, very brave. So please meet them. Here they are. Of course, there's Carl Beattie, Dr. Kieran O'Keefe, there's Ian Cash, Stuart Torrevel, and Kath Howe. And two new members that are joining the team. There is Shaggy on sound and Chris, who's going to be our cameraman. Here they all come. How on earth are you feeling, guys?
Well, it's amazing. Absolutely amazing.
7 hours. I mean, David's just said how he's going to cope with the whole thing. How are we going to cope as a group, as a team? You know, what are we going to do?
We're going to do what we always do. We're going to stick together. We're going to hunt the paranormal in what I think is probably the scariest place we have ever been in our entire lives.
And we've all had some nightmares as well, some of us, so we're feeling very apprehensive about it. I know, I certainly am. So, who's going to steer the ship for Most Haunted Live over the next 7 hours? Who's going to be our host? It's the lovely, it's very, very nice to have him here. It's our host, and your host, Mr. Paul Ross. Hello.
Hello, what an amazing and awe-inspiring place. And the thought that something like 75,000 men and women were condemned to spend years of their lives within these walls is guaranteed to make the hairs on the back of everyone's neck just prickle ever so slightly. So with that cheery thought in mind, let's get this long and unique night of paranormal investigation underway. Yvette and the team, good luck. Let's begin the vigil.
Thanks, Paul.
Pretty sure we are in for a fantastic night of ghost hunting. I'm hoping you're getting some sense of this building, the crumbling walls, the atmosphere just oozing from these cells. I'm not psychic at all, but I felt chills as I came in here tonight. And I want to introduce you now to somebody very special, somebody else who's new to the team. It's our princess of all things interactive. You'll be in touch with the show via her. It's Aditi Roy. Hello, Aditi.
Hello,
how are you
Paul.
Doing?
Great to be here today. I'm particularly excited to hear from all the viewers at home.
Now, are you a skeptic? Are you open-minded about this? What's your view on the paranormal?
Oh, I'm absolutely open-minded about this.
Okay, and we're doing something rather special tonight. Carl said the team are going to stick together. Mm-hmm. I say to Carl, oh, no, you're not, because the viewers watching now, everybody watching now, can choose which member of the team goes to death row on their own. That's got to be spooky.
Yes, definitely it has to be. And viewers can give us their feedback through a number of different ways, text messages, emails, things of that nature, and I'm going to be talking about that a little bit later.
Okay, lots to get through. It's going to be a long, long night, 7 hours for them. Aditi, thank you very much.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you. Now, David mentioned stamina. He mentioned pacing himself. I hope you're going to stay with us for the next 7 hours. I hope you pace yourself as well. But for the team, just think about what they've been through. Of course, they've flown here from the United Kingdom, a long flight, 7-8 hours. We've had the time difference. We've been here a few days. We're acclimatized, but we're going to be with you until 3 o'clock tomorrow morning. The weather's changing here already a little bit in Philadelphia. We had some spots of rain. There may be thunder and lightning later on, which will make things even more dramatic for the team. And already, as with so many old buildings, we're getting that sense of the plasterwork shifting. We're hearing strange noises. There are some animals here. There are birds. There are maybe rats and bats around. Although this is open to the public, of course, and they keep an eye on those things, nature has a way of creeping in. So there'll be natural shocks, and maybe tonight, paranormal shocks. Now, David Wells, our medium clairvoyant, is incredibly sensitive. We do want to hear from you, and Aditi will tell you how later, if you sense anything while watching the program. And also on hand to check any scientific facts, any change in temperature, we have Dr. Kieran O'Keefe. If any information emerges, any names, any dates, they'll be cross-referenced and sourced by this woman. We brought her all the way from England. It's our academic and historian, the lovely Leslie Smith. Wow, a trip to... These places are so claustrophobic, these shells.
They were meant to be, yes. This place opened in 1829, a place of reforming vision, but in fact turned out to be, of course, somewhere of despair, mental illness, death, and some would argue torture.
And also, it's been a particularly humid day here in Philadelphia. You are probably in the hottest part of the prison.
Thank you. I am. I certainly am. And of course, as a historian, I'm very used to going to very old buildings. And I have to say, though, this place takes some beating.
Okay, more from Leslie in a moment. For the moment, Leslie, thank you very much. We're about to take the shortest of short breaks. When we return, we are going to begin the vigil and tell you a little more about East State Penitentiary live from here in Philadelphia. Don't miss a moment. Back soon.
Came here at the East State Penitentiary in 1947. I was accused of murder, and I had got a life bit. I did 20 years, 8 months, 29 days here.
And this is the first cell that I was in after coming here at the East State Penitentiary in 1947.
Penitentiary in Philadelphia, where we're just beginning to hear the first rumblings of thunder in the distance. It's going to be a wet night and a bumpy ride. Over the next 7 hours, we're going to be doing our best to unravel some of the mysterious secrets of Eastern State Penitentiary, and who knows, maybe meet some of its ghostly occupants. To give you a little taste of its past, here's a look back at Eastern State Penitentiary.
Deep in the heart of the city of brotherly love sits the brooding Gothic edifice that is Eastern State Penitentiary. Designed to strike terror into the hearts and minds of offenders and to deter them from the commission of crime. Its construction was heavily influenced by the Quakers, amongst other social reformers, who held that wrongdoers could be rehabilitated through religious instruction, labor, and solitary confinement. They believed this lone incarceration away from human contact would lead inmates to penitence, the root word that gives us penitentiary. In its early days, it housed men, women, and children.
Now, I've never pretended to have psychic abilities, but I can see in all our futures a particularly impressive and maybe terrifying night. Let's get straight to Yvette Fielding and the vigil team for their first foray into Eastern State Penitentiary. Yvette, how are you doing?
Hi, Paul. We're actually here in cell block 14. As you can see, we haven't gone to night vision yet. We just wanted to give everybody a sense of what this place is like. There's dripping water coming from above us. We can hear the rumbling of thunder in the distance. It really is horrific. The paint is peeling off the walls. You can still see that there's, you know, what the old cell blocks look like now. They look absolutely awful. It's getting darker and darker by the minute. So should we just have a walk, guys, and just see what we pick up? Now, it's really wet on the floor as well. So if it starts raining, we're in trouble as well. So, David, what comes to mind straight away as we're walking in this particular area?
Well, I mean, the whole prison, as soon as you walk through those doors, it's really oppressive. You know, emotionally, I feel exhausted already, like a few minutes in.
Yeah.
And I think it's the... There's a real mixture here. There's almost like a reverent silence. And then there's also this, you know, this clutter and noise. In this part, though, I'm very aware of two... It's water, I think.
Water, yeah. Two?
Two astrals, right. Already. One seems to be a guard.
A guard?
One's a guard, and one is a... I can't quite get a grip on him.
When you say the guard, can you see what he looks like?
He's more Victorian than anything. He's perhaps into the 1900s.
Mm-hmm.
The problem I have is I don't know who's associated with what wing, because we're here, they can sometimes come to you straight away.
And this is such a massive place.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, this guard, how did he die? Why is he still here?
He's appearing to me. Sorry, I'm having a bit of a struggle. Just
go. Sorry, was that someone doing that above us?
It's not above us.
Did you hear that?
Oh,
like something was about to fall.
Like it was on the edge of fire. Yeah.
Sorry, go on, David.
His throat's gaping open, so his throat's been cut. I can see his throat, and I can see the flesh opening up, and it's almost like he's showing me that. It's almost like he's lifting his head like that, so I can see it. So I can actually physically see this.
And how old is this guard?
He's in his 40s.
He's in his 40s, and who would have slashed his throat?
It was a prisoner.
A prisoner here.
Yeah, yeah.
And when would this have happened? When did he die?
This is 1940s, 1942, 43.
Oh, so quite recent.
Yeah,
then.
Absolutely.
Okay, any name with him yet? I know it's very early. Any name with this guard?
Not at the moment.
No.
No, there's no name with him at the moment. He's actually quite mocking me. It's almost like, do you know, I tell you exactly what I'm seeing. It's like the gaping wound in his neck is talking to me.
Oh, that's horrible.
It's like that's communicating to me, which is like mocking me. It's taking the mickey out.
So it's like a really bad dream. It's like something you see in a nightmare.
Absolutely.
Now, you mentioned this other guy as well, this other gentleman. You know, what does he look like? Who is he?
He's quite young, and there seems to be younger souls around here, one or two. Almost, they're showing me, they're telling me the age, or helping me with that, because I can see someone shaving and taking the mickey out of the fact that they're shaving, because they don't need to shave.
Right.
You know, they've got hardly any whiskers there at all. So I know that they're quite young.
Okay.
But I can't get more of a fix on him. It's more images, so it may be residual. The guard's strong, but this might be residual.
So this guy might be residual, but the guard is definitely strong in this particular area now.
Yeah.
Well, why don't we walk back the way we came?
Okay.
And if you guys want to walk along that way and see, you know, if we get anything, if you're picking up on anything else, and maybe we can go to the top floor. Oh, gosh, sorry. You just freak out a little bit when you've got... There's a very small team of us here. There's basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Something was thrown. Something either fell or was thrown.
Right. And it looked, because it came past me, it looked white. There could have been a...
plaster or something from the walls. Also, there's the stalactite things falling down as well.
Yeah.
So, okay. I tell you what, there's still a little bit of daylight. You all right?
Right.
What was that?
What's the matter?
Was it a stone?
Something fell down there then. You all right, babe?
It went. It just went. Sorry.
Where did it come from?
From over there.
You're kidding.
So what?
From where?
I don't know what it was. The light thing just went. Came from over there.
Okay. Okay, whoever you are, do that again. If there's a spirit here, please do it again. Throw something. Bang one of the doors. Let's keep walking, guys. Let's keep walking. Let's hear your voice. As I was saying, there's only a tiny little bit of daylight left. And, it's already very, very dark in here, so what the heck it's going to be like later on, I have no idea. We're all very jumpy. As you can see, we are very jumpy. Let's keep going. I want to know more about this guard and anybody else that might be here, that might be haunting this place. And also, why would he want to haunt here if he's had his throat cut? You'd think he'd want to leave.
You don't know the reasons behind it. That's what I'm trying to get to, because that's the first question I ask. And particularly when it comes to prisoners, if you're incarcerated in a place, why the hell do you want to haunt it? You really don't want to do that.
No.
You know, so that does intrigue me.
Should we go up to the next floor, guys? Yeah, let's do that. Okay. We'll just go up. I'm going to go up first. Okay. Oh, God, so creepy. Oh, God.
You all right?
Oh, just being rained on. Oh, it's even worse up here. It's so decrepit. There's even plants coming through the floor. It's horrific. What it must have been like,
Connie,
for these people, you can't even begin to imagine. And there's such an oppressive atmosphere in here. Mm. It's very, very close, isn't it, Kieran? It is.
I mean, remember, the humidity is over 70%. Because we've got storms and it is very hot. We're talking about 26, 27 degrees, which I guess we're in America, so it's 80 degrees Fahrenheit.
See, this would have been a shower block, so that would have been where they would have showered in there. Right, David?
Yes.
Okay, just so we know, the reason why we're doing our daylight walk around is so that when we come back and we turn all the lights off, it just gives everybody a chance to see what this place looks like. Because, of course, when we get a night vision, we're going to see nothing. So,
Yvette,
this is what...
We've just heard from here, so like men's voices, sort of a low-level talking.
What? What?
Just here.
Let's go back there, wait, go on.
There's no one down there, we know that.
Where did you hear it from?
Just down there.
Just down here.
Who do you think it is? This is definitely this guard, David, or
I don't think this is the guard. I think there's a couple of very dark shadows that are playing with this, and I can't get any fix on them because they are purposely keeping it that way, you know?
So that at the moment they're just staying back.
No, well, they're just not letting me near them at all. It's almost, I tell you how they appear as well, they're appearing as shadows, which always is a negative force for me. But they're appearing very thin and not quite human. They are human, but they're doing that to scare people. Almost like their limbs taper to points rather than hands and legs.
Oh, how weird.
But they're presenting like that just to kind of...
And all day, while the whole team has been here, we've all been experiencing some really strange things. Whistling, stone throwing, some really strange noises, tapping. It's been going on, and it's not just the investigation team that have been experiencing this. We're talking about the whole crew. There's some American crew members and English crew members, and we're all... We can't believe how alive this place feels. It's amazing. So now that we've had a look around here... are you guys ready to start our true investigation?
Yeah?
Yeah, we've got a feel for the place. I hope everybody at home has got a feel for the place. This is the kind of thing that we're working with here. So it's back to you, Paul. We're going to switch all the lights off and we're going to turn all our night vision cameras on. Wish us luck. So it's back to you, Paul.
Thank you, Yvette. I certainly do wish them luck. David sensed dark shadows. A murdered guard speaking through his mutilated throat, and the sun hasn't even set. When we come back, we'll be telling you how you can get involved. See you in a moment.
My name is Francis Dolan. I'm the site manager here at Eastern State Penitentiary Historic Site. I really enjoy working in the building. I like all of the visitors to the site, the ones you can see and the ones you can't see.
Welcome back to Most Haunted Live from Eastern State Penitentiary in Philadelphia, where the time is rapidly approaching 8:30 Eastern Time, that is. I'm Paul Ross, and we are here in the penitentiary, and our moon torchlight vigil is about to begin. We're going to go to night vision very soon, and we want you to stay involved. Telling you how you can go interactive with us, let's welcome back Aditi Roy.
Aditi. Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Paul. We definitely want everyone to get involved. And one of the ways that you can get involved is taking a very close look at our webcams. There are 8 of them located throughout the facility. And at any given time, we're going to be streaming 4 of them live on the web. Let's take a closer look with a map of the prison. As you can see from this map, all of these 8 webcams are basically interspersed throughout the facility. Don't forget to record the approximate time if you see anything unusual or experience any other paranormal phenomena. Now, to see those webcams, all you need to do is go on our website. That's travelchannel.com/most haunted. Now let's take a look at each of those webcams. Webcam 1 is in the warden's office. You can see the last bits of daylight there. Webcam 2 is in the visitation room. Webcam 3 is outside Al Capone's cell. Again, little bits of daylight in the very back. Webcam 4 is in cell block 12. Webcam 5 is in the recovery part of the hospital block. Webcam 6 is in the operating room, another part of the hospital block. Looks kind of spooky in there. Webcam 7 is in the guard tower, and webcam 8 is on death row. As I said, we'll be alternating among all of these webcams throughout the evening, so take a very close look at them and send us your thoughts. If you spot anything usual, definitely let us know. There are a number of ways that you can give us your feedback, and one of those ways is to visit our message boards right on our website. In order for you to do that, all you have to do is go to travelchannel.com/most haunted, or you can also send us your text messages. And to do that, all you need to do is text the keywords boo, then a space, then cam to 99799. Follow the keywords with details of your sightings. Now, if you want to receive text message alerts from us, all you have to do is text the keywords boo news to 99799 to receive free text alerts about Most Haunted and Most Haunted Live. And remember to text us or email us your thoughts on which individual team member you want to be alone on death row. Remember to do that. We'd also like to see, remember to see your psychic art faxes. And basically what that is any sorts of images or faces or anything that you conjure up when you're watching our program here at the Eastern State Penitentiary tonight. Sketch what you see and then fax that sketch over to us. Our fax number is 215-765-6198. And just a bit later on in the program, I'm going to be telling you about a brand new special feature that you can download right onto your cell phone. This is brand new. We haven't ever done this on the program before. It is absolutely unprecedented, so you'll definitely want to stick around for that. Lots of things to look forward to, Paul.
Thank you, Aditi. And don't forget, we want to hear from you about which member of our vigil team should spend some time alone on death row. More on that later. Right now, we're going to catch up with the fascinating history of this prison, courtesy of our academic and historian, Leslie Smith. Hello,
hi,
Leslie.
Hi.
Now, we talked very briefly about the prison, what a fascinating building it is. In its own way, it's unique in history, certainly in penal history, isn't it?
It was absolutely groundbreaking, and that's because I think you should remember that after the American Civil War, there was a great urge to change many things and reform and do things better. And here in Pennsylvania, certainly, that was well and truly underway with a society that was about the business of reforming the lives of prisoners. And so people put out to bid, and a British-born architect called John Haviland, in fact, won the bid, and the place was built. And it was so revolutionary that, in fact, it had central heating and it had running water at a time when President Jackson had just arrived there in the White House, and he didn't have it.
And it was copied all over the world, this design?
Oh, yeah, we think as many as 300 prisons, in fact, came off this idea, and it's, in fact, on this basis of the spokes coming away from the wheel.
It's got a kind of monastic feel to it as well, hasn't it, about contemplation?
Absolutely, and not an accident. I mean, we've heard a little bit about it, but the point was Haviland and others felt it would be a great thing to get people, if you like, that the prison wasn't the punishment, but an opportunity to reform. It's a marvellous idea, isn't it? So consequently, they looked at monasteries where, of course, monks and nuns were close to God in small cells and hoped that this quietness would, in fact, achieve the same effect, if you like, in the prisoners, and they'd become reformed with God's light coming through the ceiling.
And even the guards were encouraged to be silent.
When you actually realise what was done, it's terrifying now, because we understand so much about mental health and the stress of it, the panic and the distress. Even the guards had to wear socks over their shoes, padding around. You didn't hear anyone. There were exercise yards that were totally private for one prisoner, like a dog yard when you go to the kennel. These poor souls just didn't have any sense of another life.
Now, we can hear the slight patter of rain already on the roof. That could have been possibly their only noise from the outside world, because when this was built, it was in farmlands Philadelphia.
Absolutely, we forget this is a mile away from the city there. But it was so revolutionary, and this marvellous medieval facade outside. No wonder John Haviland, being British-born, would know a bit about castles, you see, and you can see that here. People came to look at it, I mean, in their thousands.
Dickens visited, but he wasn't completely impressed, was he?
No, Charles Dickens, the great writer from Britain, of course, he came in, recognised what people were trying to do. He was a social reformer himself. And when he came here and saw it, he just said, he saw some work a man had done, an artist, and said, and when I looked into his face, I saw he was completely blank, you know, insane. This life had driven people to complete insanity, panic, suicide. It was a desperate place.
So a dark history. We've got some information for you already. We're going to hear what you've made of some of the things David Wells has sent.
Yes, I've got something.
Thank you for the moment there, Leslie. You're watching Most Haunted Live. When we return, our vigil in night vision will commence. Don't go anywhere.
My name is Robert C. Snake Williams. I was a correctional officer from 1965 to 1970. The structure itself, I think, has a spirit, and it collected a whole lot of things over the centuries that it's been here. This place is alive.
Humid night. You can probably hear the rain pounding down on the roof of this ancient building. In a moment, Yvette Fielding and the team will start their night vision vigil, and they're starting at the entrance to the prison. Here's some facts about it and maybe what they can expect.
The imposing Gothic outer walls housing the main entrance and administration block would have been a convicted prisoner's first sight of the Eastern State Penitentiary. Purposefully designed to strike terror into the hearts and minds of offenders and to deter them from the commission of crime. In the 1920s, brick sentry boxes were added to the walls and machine guns installed. By 1938, an additional front gateway had been constructed. Final confirmation that the earlier ideals of penitence and rehabilitation had now been firmly superseded by the necessity to securely house hardened criminals away from decent citizens. The main administration block housed the warden's office, who made certain that the focus was now on strict discipline in order to contain the overburgeoning prison population. This control would often involve the withholding of basic humanitarian rights, such as visits from home, something every prisoner would look forward to as brief respite from the harsh reality of penitentiary life. We can only guess at the scenes that would take place in the rather supernaturally named visitation room, where inmates met with their loved ones or their lawyers and perhaps rue the day that they ever entered the prison.
So without further ado, let's get straight to Yvette Fielding and the team as they begin the vigil in earnest. Yvette, where are you, Yvette?
Hi, Paul. We're just walking up the steps. We've turned our cameras to night vision. We're in the administration block. God, it's so dark. Very creepy place. There's various rooms off this very, very long corridor. And hopefully we might hear some sounds or noises as we're walking along. Now, David, what are you getting in this particular part of the building? I mean, this is the front of the prison.
What I'm getting is, I'm walking up this corridor, it's like someone's like doing this, pushing, because if you're walking against me, so if you try to walk, it's like that.
Oh, so someone's
pushing
you back.
Against me, yes, the energy's pushing me back. Obviously, I'm going forward, I don't particularly want to.
Who's pushing you back then?
It's an energy, it's like a big wall at the moment. And I think it's a general thing that it's just not wanted, I'm just not wanted.
You're not wanted, or we're not wanted.
Well, we're not wanted, but they'll focus.
Okay.
Focus on the energy.
All right.
That I'm pushing out.
Now this room here would have been someone's, a nice room. We've got a fireplace here. Quite a big space, isn't it? So, who do you think would have occupied this particular part of the building?
I can see in my mind's eye. I can see a fattish man.
Yeah.
A round man. He has a here's a uniform on. I think he's kind of come and going to another. There's two men. One is even bigger than he is, so he can like his food a bit. Like you say, it's administration. I think warden.
Yeah.
It's been a warden here, but later. This seems like later in its history.
When you say later, when later?
1920s. Yeah, it feels very, and when I'm asking for clues, that's what I'm getting, 1920s. There's a name. William is the first name.
Okay, this is the warden.
Yeah, I think he's a warden. Yeah, he's definitely a warden or this other man who's coming and going,
okay.
William. And I can feel someone tying knotted sheets together and hoiking himself out this window.
Really?
Or one of these windows, yeah. So I don't know if there was ever an escape from this part of the building.
Okay, well,
feels like that.
I'm sure Leslie will be able to put us right on that.
It's kind of comedy, really. Do you know the old knotted sheets
there? Yeah.
It would be good to know how long he was a warden, because then we could establish whether he's linked to any of the other characters that we pick up.
It's hard to tell, Kieran. They're not. It's almost like they're doing their business, going about their business. Do you know what I mean?
Okay.
And he's eating, I can see him.
So he's eating. So he's quite a portly gentleman.
Yeah.
How old would he have been when he was...
50s.
Okay, so quite old. And this other gentleman, again, he was quite big too.
Yeah, he's coming and going.
And he's the one that put the sheets together and went...
He may have been. He seems to have been... The food is important.
Okay.
Because they wouldn't have shown me food just to say he's gutsy.
Okay.
And food's important.
Is this warden present here now in this room?
No, it's like a residual.
Okay,
like a residual,
so you're
energy.
Picking up on the memory of who would have been
memory, here. Yeah,
there's
a memory, absolutely,
okay.
Absolute memory.
Let's just take this time, just so I just want to get the feelings of every crew member here. Now, Shaggy, we call you Shaggy because we think you look like Shaggy from Scooby-Doo. You're on sound. This is a first for you. How are you feeling so far?
It's pretty eerie. I don't know, a lot of stuff happened in here.
But you feel...
And everything, I don't know, like you can tell there's... I don't know, bad vibes.
Okay, and earlier on when we were in the other part of the building, when we had the lights on, you actually...
I got hit by something.
You got what?
I got hit, something hit me in the arm.
Okay. Now, how do you feel, Kath?
I had a really, really strange experience before. Even before we were on air, I just burst out into tears. I have never, ever done that before, and it's really, really freaked me out. I couldn't breathe. I was sobbing. I don't know why. And I am so, so scared about being in here. Really, really scared.
Carl?
Well, I've got to say, all day long when we came here earlier to get set up to do the shoot, just weird stuff's been happening to everybody. And even the real big skeptics on the crew are walking out of this place, believers. And for me, I'm scared. I'm scared like I've never been scared before. I want to go. I want to get out.
Wigan, how are you feeling? Wigan's over there.
same as everyone, I really feel really scared and on edge, but then I just nearly went right over the top then, because I just totally and absolutely cacked my pants, because I just nearly went head first through the bloody floor.
Oh yeah, look at that, oh my god.
But I'm alright, don't worry now. That took my mind off it for a minute.
Okay, Stuart?
How am I feeling? Something like Ian said, same as everyone, you know, I'm really nervous, I'm absolutely scared out of my mind at this moment in time, because, I mean, earlier on I was seeing things and hearing things, I couldn't explain them, and to be honest with you, I've just got this really, really bad feeling.
Okay. Now, Chris, you're on your cameraman, how are you feeling? You've had some odd experiences, haven't you?
Yeah, it's been pretty oppressive, to say the least, actually. I felt like I was touched in here when I was doing some camera tests and cabling earlier, and it's just a scary place, really.
Okay. Kieran, what about you? Now, you're here, you're a skeptic, you're a scientist, you're tooled up. You've got absolutely every piece of scientific equipment on you. How do you feel that this investigation is going to go, and what sort of things are you going to be looking for over the next, you know, so much, well, the rest of the evening?
Yeah, definitely. Well, the main thing is, because of everybody's experience, because of the way they're feeling already, I have to remain, if it's possible, even more objective to you know, not try and get sucked into what I think is a little bit of psychology, you know, but I'm ready for physical phenomena. You know, I'm going to be measuring temperature, all the environmental stuff, paying attention to psychology. But, you know, if things do start getting thrown, if there are physical effects from people, then I might be at a loss for an explanation later.
What sort of equipment have you got with you very quickly?
I've got loads. This is a laser thermometer, so I can measure temperature on surfaces, on the floor, that sort of thing. Probe to look for cold spots, EMF meter, and then, like you can see, I'm kitted up with everything else to measure infrasound, humidity, air pressure, you name it.
We've got thermal imaging camera
as well. Thermal imaging camera as well, which is a very important piece
of kit. Is it worth, David, while we're in this particular part, you're saying it's residual energy that we're getting. Do you want to move on somewhere else, or do you want to stay here and just call out and see if we get anything?
I think it's worth calling out because it sends a signal to anyone who's listening, and there's more than a few listening. I can sense that.
Really? Okay.
Yeah,
do you want to call out then?
If there's anyone here, any astrals in this building, in this prison, come towards us now. I think I can hear tapping. I'm not sure. It's difficult because of outside noise, but...
Yeah. Okay.
Can anyone else hear it?
I can't hear anything at the moment, no.
It's very difficult.
It is very difficult.
I'm hearing a low murmur of voices, but it...
Well, I tell you what, let's go back down there. Is that where you're hearing them from, Carl?
It's either here or next door.
Okay, well, I can hear the tapping now.
Yeah.
I don't know where it's coming from. It's very, very difficult to hear.
Hard.
Should we walk back down that way? Everybody, should we just walk backwards? Watch yourself. Whoa, there's so much rubbish here on the floor. It's crazy. Okay. If there's anybody here, if there's any astral beings, if there's any spirit people here that wish to talk to us.
What was that then?
What?
Flash.
What?
What was that flash?
What flash?
It's
where?
It's a big ball of light.
Yeah, it might be lightning. Is there lightning?
That wasn't lightning. That came from the room and it came straight across. You must have seen that.
No, I didn't. No, I didn't see it. Jesus, that's lightning. A thunder. Sorry. Okay. In here?
Yes. It came from that room and then it just shot straight across the corridor to this wall.
Can't go any further than here.
There is a window in the far side, yes.
If there's anybody here, please give us a sign. Let us know that you're around. Talk to us. Throw something or make a noise. Touch somebody. Do something so that we know that you're here. Can you sense anyone, David?
I do sense someone, but I'm sensing... I tell you what I'm getting. They're using dark subconscious imagery with me because they're trying to scare me. And what I've got is a great big dark shape who's controlling it. And you know how we always have one that controls? If there's a lot, there's one who's stronger than the other. And this one is almost like... you know, this big, he's presenting massive, and he's really, it's like a black molten shape that's spreading out through the whole prison.
Oh my God.
It's one individual. It's almost like, if you can imagine the legs of a spider
on
the prison, that's what he's presenting, is that like, it's all mine and you won't have it. It's like, it's all mine and you will not have it.
Oh yes, we will. We will. We're coming. Come on. Come on, we're not scared of you. Do something to let us know that you're here. Make a noise or throw something. See, I can't wait to get into the heart of the prison. That's what I want to do.
Yeah.
So, Paul, we're gonna think about where we want to go next. It's back to you. Some very interesting stuff there that I hope Leslie will be able to help us out with. So back to you, Paul.
Thank you, Yvette. She's working away even as we speak. This is Most Haunted Live from Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. Not much love being sent in Eastern State Penitentiary tonight. Join us for more after this. Investigation into the history of Eastern State Penitentiary, Philadelphia, continues. Now, we've asked for your interaction. You've given it to us. The response has been fantastic. So overwhelming, in fact, that our message boards are moving rather slowly. Please bear with us. Be patient. We're working hard to resolve it, but we do want your input to continue because it is vital. Please get involved. We are now going straight back to the vigil with Yvette Fielding. Remarkable scenes already, Yvette.
Hi, Paul. I'm just coming through the gate here. We've come into a place that's, again, just has the most awful atmosphere. I don't think there's anywhere in this place that has a nice atmosphere. It's really quite grim. And where I'm going to take you to now is just, to me, you know, just sums up a lot of the things that happen here, which, of course, is this visitation. The visitation room. So this is where all the prisoners would have come. They would have met with their attorneys. They would have met with their loved ones. And David, I was thinking it would be quite a good idea if I sat on this side, which is where the visitors would have been, if you go around the other side, which is where the prisoner would have been.
Okay. I'm not very happy about it.
You're not?
Oh.
Shh. Ah.
Okay.
The bench. I think someone just moved the bench. Okay. Sorry, we're very jumpy.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll sit here. And obviously this would have had glass, and there would have been, I think, telephones and...
Jeez.
Are you all right, David?
Yeah, I'm okay.
Now, as you can see, we're experiencing slight technical difficulties now with our cabling. We have done this on the show many times before. We've never quite had the intensity of problems we've experienced over the last couple of days. There are literally, though, miles of our cables in Eastern State Penitentiary. This is an absolutely vast building, so I know you're going to bear with us as we sort out these minor technical glitches. To remind you, we've already had some amazing results from David Wells. He got the sense of a spirit of a guard with his throat cut, who was talking to him, mocking him through the wound in his throat. He got the sense of two wardens, possibly both wardens, portly men, right near the entrance, talking, going about their business. He's also sensing dark shadows, and we've heard noises and seen lights from inside the cells. And this is just the beginning. By my reckoning, we now have 6 more hours of investigation from here inside Eastern State Penitentiary, and it is, of course, vitally important that you keep watching and that you stay in touch with us. I think I'm being told we might be able to return to Yvette and the vigil any moment now, so do please stay with us. Also, coming up later in the show, Aditi Roy will be telling you more about how you can get involved. Remember, we're going to be sending one of our team into death row alone. Who do you think it should be? You're getting to know them now as characters if you've not seen the show before. So you can make your decision, and Aditi will tell you who you can consign to death row for a very special investigation. That's still to come. Let's go now, if we can. I think we've sorted out the cabling problem, if indeed that's what it was, to Yvette Fielding in night vision. Yvette, that was very strange.
Hi, Paul. Yeah, we did have some technical difficulties, but we are back on air. We're fine now. So, David, you're on one side of this awful screen. This is where they would have come and spoken to their loved ones, as I said, their attorneys. Mm. What sort of things are you picking up? You're not happy, I know you're not.
I'm not happy at all. I mean, I can feel the emotion of the place. I feel, you know, there's... the one energy that's really strong with me is hopelessness, obviously. But it's deeper than that. It's almost like it's a hopelessness because not... Is it someone tapping?
Somebody tapping on here.
Someone's tapping on this bench here.
Because there's tapping going on this bench, on here. Did you...
Yeah, definitely felt it. My elbows are on the table, but that's all.
Chris, you don't lean on. I know it's not you, but just so we can discount the possibility that there's leaning on
the lightning is so strong out there as well. All right, David. Whoa,
ooh.
Look at those lights. You okay, David?
I'm okay. I feel massively emotional. I don't feel comfortable. I'm not happy. I've just had footsteps behind me. There's thunder and lightning.
Okay. Footsteps behind you.
I heard someone shuffle behind me. I heard a shuffling, but with shackles. I heard like 2 feet and like chick of chains behind me.
Okay.
I can't pick up on any individuals because I'm picking up on a lot of residual.
Okay.
Temperature's dropping here at my side.
You get that, Kira?
Ah!
What's the matter?
Jesus Christ!
Oh, fuck. Sorry.
What happened?
Sorry, I just thought someone literally just came right on my back like that.
You alright?
Something just smacked me in the leg.
Something smacked you in the leg?
Yeah, something just grabbed my leg.
Something just grabbed your leg?
Yeah.
Crying.
What, like lightly or hard?
No, grabbed my leg.
Okay. Come on, whoever's here, then do something else. Did you do that?
That was me.
Okay.
Breathing out, yeah, that's me.
Who is it? Who's here with us now?
There's this person in shackles. Really big man again. Different one, it's not the same one.
If there's anybody here, if there's any astral beings, if there's any spirit people that wish to communicate with us, please touch somebody again. We don't mean you any harm. We can help you if you feel trapped here. Please come forward. Please come and help us. Oh, can you hear it?
Tapping. Yeah,
Shaggy?
Yeah.
Where are you?
I can you?
Okay. I think... Okay. Everybody keep your feet still. If you are here, please can you tap loudly for me twice? It's behind David. Can you pick it up? Can you see, Shaggy?
Do you want to go around?
Yeah. You okay there?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Please, can you make the taps much louder for us, please? If you're here, tap twice. Can you hear it over there?
Just walking past. It's round here.
It's round there.
Yeah. But it's moving back again.
It's moving backwards and forwards. We don't mean you any harm. Perhaps maybe you can copy me. If I knock, can you knock back?
What was that?
There's
something in there. Is there anybody in there?
Anybody in there?
Okay.
Okay. Please, I will knock twice. Can you knock back? Yes, I heard that then. It was very quiet, but I can't tell you where the heck... Someone kicked the bench. Someone kicked the bench?
No one's close enough to the bench.
Someone kicked the bench. Did you not hear it?
Yeah.
I heard the bench.
Something. Yeah. Was it the bench? Did you feel it on the bench?
I sat here and the bench moved. It was like someone really kicked it.
Chris is a good foot away from the bench and has not moved. No one else is near him.
Okay. Do it again. Kick the bench again. Can you hear that? Kieran, are you getting anything?
No, temperature, there's no difference. I'm standing next to David with the probe. EMF, I'm on zero. I know Carl has downloaded the ghost detector on his phone. I'm getting zero on my uniaxial EMF meter. Are you getting anything on yours, Carl?
It's kind of, I'm actually trying to kind of work out the points. I'm not getting a strong reading. Every now and then I'm getting, it goes right into the red.
Right.
But then it'll go back down into the green.
So it's fluctuating.
It'll level out somewhere in the middle, but it's not giving me anything that I would say is definitive at the moment.
Okay.
But it's giving me a reading.
Okay, thanks.
If you are here, please bang the bench again or touch David. Oh, can you hear it? Please copy me. That's me. Copy me again. Make it loud. There it is. It's over there. Do you get it? It's over here. It's by everyone. Are you male? If you are, tap twice. Oh my God! It's right here and it's just made the bench creak. It's just made the bench creak.
Are you getting that, Jen?
No.
If you hear, please bang on this. Bang on this, if you can hear us.
Make sure everybody's stepping away from the bench so they're on the other side of the corridor.
Or kick the bench again.
Thanks.
There, can you hear it?
I can hear it creaking, yeah.
Kick this bench or make another noise for us. Or perhaps you can throw something or touch one of us here in the room. Any more information about this guy, this prisoner?
No, there's nothing at the moment. I just have this horrible feeling that we're just being teased and pulled back to the center of that web.
Well, where I want to...
What
was that?
Hell
was
sounded
that?
Like it came down from here.
That was mass...
Really loud tapping.
Where, it is! Shaggy, you need to get round here. There's loud tapping too.
Stay down there, yeah.
My legs feel like concrete.
Do you mean there's any harm if you do tap twice for yes, once for no? Do you mean there's any harm? Yeah, it's right here. Do you get it, Shaggy?
Yeah, I heard it.
Okay, so you've got it. Yeah. You've got it. Okay. Do you want me to... You got it?
I got it.
Okay. Okay.
I feel quite sick.
Can you please tap out how many spirits are here in this penitentiary?
What was that?
What was that?
That came from the courtyard event. Just on the other side of that window.
There's a great big massive garden in the wall, isn't there?
There's no one there.
In there.
Let's just see if we can get some more knocks. Just okay, guys?
Yep.
Stand still.
Okay.
If you can hear me, can you please knock twice?
We have begun with a burst of intense paranormal activity, and we still have a long, long way to go. The vigil is continuing. I know you'll be with us after this break.
Ah! What's the matter?
Someone literally just came right.